Hi, it's Gadget UK here again. Just looking at my Panasonic 3DO again. This is working fine. Well, I say fine, it's working 99.9% fine. I played a few games for numerous hours. I played Alone in the Dark, got most of the way through it. But then there's a few things that I needed to do and I didn't do at the time. One of them was to replace the battery. Now, it is holding the saves, but what happened with this, I played Alone in the Dark for a while, about a month or so back. Didn't use it for 2 or 3 weeks, then came back to use it last weekend. And it was working, the save game was still there, but I suspected it was slightly corrupted. Maybe the battery had, you know, lost, the battery level would have dropped a little bit over those 2 or 3 weeks, especially because it has an original battery that had never been replaced. And as a result, it probably lost the odd byte or a couple of bits changed state there in the SRAM. So it wouldn't let me put things on the floor. Well, I could drop items in the game. I couldn't pick them back up again. It was like it totally glitched out. And it seemed to be all around the save. As soon as you start a new game, you could drop items and pick them up. No problems at all. And the other thing I noticed, I played it for several hours because I got quite far into it last weekend. Start from scratch, I deleted my save game. Start from scratch, got quite a long way through it. And after about 3 or 4 hours, there was a particular screen I was on, and I went back to the previous screen, and like 50% way down the screen, it was like corrupted graphics, but the game was fine. And I went back off the screen onto another screen, that screen was okay, I went back to the one with the corrupted screen, it was still corrupted halfway down. Now, straight away I was thinking, okay, well, that's a bit strange, it's not crashed, so, you know, there's obviously nothing wrong with the core part of the system there, but there's this graphical thing appeared, you know. Call it what you will, you know, like I say, 50% of the screen corrupted. So then I start thinking about VRAM, you know, so that's a possibility. I might have to, at some point, swap out the VRAM on this. But the other thing I wanted to do with this, and it may well tie in with that graphical corruption thing, is the main smoothing cap, if you like, or ballast cap, call it what you will, which I think somewhere like 6,800 microfarad. So I've ordered one of those. I'll just see if I can find it. Where's it gone? Yeah, so here's the replacement cap I've got. It's a Panasonic. Might as well keep it Panasonic. It's all Panasonic. 6,800 microfarad, 35 volts. I don't think it needs to be as quite as high as 35 volts, but that's a similar sort of physical size to the one that's on there. Hopefully it should fit. This is one of these snapping ones, so might have to modify the board slightly to accommodate this, but it's a good quality one and all the rest of it, so that, it's important to do that, and that might solve the problem. I don't know, it may be that the VRAM there, the caps that are related to that need replacing. I'm not sure, there's probably going to be a couple of sort of 10 microfarad or 100 microfarad electrolytics. I might just swap those out as well, or certainly measure them while I'm there. So I'll whip the lid off now and we'll have a look inside. Right, so I've got the board out, that's the cap I'm going to swap. I'm probably going to take the smaller one off as well. I don't know what that is. Is it 1200 or something, or 1000 microfarad? I think it's 1000 actually. I'll take that out. I'll check, confirm that in a minute. And I'm going to swap that one out as well, because then all three of these on the power supply here will have been done. I did measure around a lot of these other ones at the time, couldn't find a problem. The battery, I'll measure that in a minute. Let's just see what voltage that is. It's not been used for a week or two, so I would expect it could be pretty low, and that, you know, we'll see how high that is, and that's going to dictate whether I'm going to swap that out or not. So with regards to the this graphics problem, you know, if it's not a power supply anything, there's a possibility it could be something wrong with one of these, the main ASICs here. I doubt it, because it seems very irregular, you know. It could be a dry joint, but it doesn't look, you know, they look really good. The solder points on the Madam and Cleo chips here look really good. But coming back to the VRAM, this is the interesting thing. I've had a look at the spec for this, and it's got 2 megabytes of DRAM and 1 megabyte of VRAM. Now, I can't for the life of me work out the way that that's working, because if you look at this now, I've looked up the part number of these chips here, and I got this, I think I missed a digit off when I did this last time. It's a KM428C257J-7. These are VRAMs as far as I understand, and we've got those two, But then these look, yeah, these are identical down here. So you've got four, and then there's four of these. So is it a case of we've got some VRAM at the bottom, VRAM at the top, and the DRAM in the middle? It just seems a really weird way of laying them out. The part numbers on these are 424270-70s. So, yeah, I would say those probably look just like DRAMs to me. Now, it could be that they're bigger chips. So, you know, you've got half a meg, half a meg, half a meg, half a meg gives you 2 meg. And it could well be that these are 256K. I'm trying to think, yeah, 256K because you've got 1 meg of VRAM. So, yeah, maybe that's what's going on there. But it just seems a bit weird having, if that's the case, why would we got 2 up here and 2 down there? Don't know, very odd. Other thing I've looked at with this is a potential future modification regards to the backup RAM, you know, because it started, you know, I'll say I got a bit irritated with the fact that this, the battery went, but that wasn't the only problem. You've not got very much space. You can hardly store any save games on this. I don't know that it's like 32K, it probably is 32K SRAM there. Now you can get larger chips. I've seen, I had a look round for one with the same pinout, which falls within almost the same sort of spec and stuff, and I found one that's got like, I don't know, 4 times the capacity, so it's got like an extra 4 pins. Now you'd have to do, if I put this on here, I'd have to lay it in such a way that it would overlay where, you see that cap is there, I'd have to remove that cap and put the thing on that way there. Just bear with me, someone's at the door. Sorry about that, door-to-door sales. Yeah, forgot where I was at. So, yeah, this SRAM, you can get a larger chip, and you'd have to remove that cap, and you would be able to sit it on the board, so, you know, obviously the right-hand side is where the right-hand side of the chip is now, and it would extend a little bit over here. Now, there's nothing for it to make contact with. You could bend the last couple of pins up on each side. This cap, you know, you'd need to do something with, maybe relocate that with a couple of K&R wires or something, that's possible. Then you could run some sort of, you know, four-way switch or something to the upper, through the, you know, the additional address lines there, mount it on the side, and that would give you 4 times the capacity that you currently have. Probably even more, actually, because it's, I'm trying to think, yeah, no, that'd be about right. If it's 4 times the size, you can have 4 times the capacity using those upper address lines in the relevant way. There are other things you could potentially do as well. You know, you could actually mount some sort of PCMCIA socket, and as long as you use like a JEDEC 3 PC card with SRAM on it, you could probably wire something in to replace this. I know Panasonic were talking about having an add-on, something that perhaps plugged into the expansion thing. I don't know whether it went on the back or whether it went on the side, but I don't know whether that ever came to, you know, saw the light of day. I don't think it did. But that was exactly what they planned to do. Did also cross my mind that the SRAM connectivity might be mapped somewhere to one of the outside ports or something. I don't think it would be. It's not typical for that sort of thing to usually happen, but you never know. The big problem with these really is I can't find any service manuals for these. I know one or two people have got actual physical service manuals, but I've not been able to sort of trace a, you know, PDF or anything of one of those. So. Anyway, we'll measure this battery now before I start doing anything with the cap. What I'd like to try and do is try and save the game, the save games that are on there. And I think the way I'm probably going to have to do that is to charge the replacement battery up, and then potentially, I don't know, wire some sort of temporary battery or something on directly to the SRAM or something, or some connectivity, you know, some connection somewhere to continuously keep this powered while I remove this battery and put the other battery on. So I might need, you know, a couple of batteries there, at least one fully charged, just to temporarily hold that while I, you know, get it, the other one in a charged state. So I'll get the meter now and we'll measure it. Right, I should be able to get that on camera now so you can see, but this has not been used for 2 weeks, and as you will see, 3 volts. So that's good. That battery does not need replacing, and I suspect it's as much, and that's why I didn't do it at the time. But that's, you know, like I said, been left unused, uncharged, except for 2 weeks, 14 days, and it's still 3 volts, which is pretty much what they measure when they're good and they're new. And I just suspect it's because it's not had a lot of use, and they're good quality batteries anyway. But it's interesting that that doesn't need replacing. It's not what I expected. So I think we're in the realms of, you know, if you look at the issue with the SRAM, you know, the graphical corruptions as well, I do think that it just needs a few more caps replacing on here. So I'll swap out those two PSU caps now, I think. So before I swap out the cap here, I just wanted to show you something. And I spotted this last time and cleaned up a bit, but clearly it's still a bit of an issue. Can you see that pin there? It's looking a bit dark. And the solder points, I don't know how well this is going to come out here, but on that particular chip there, some of the ones near, you know, that pin, but one or two of the other ones down here as well, they just look pretty dry to me. It doesn't look like it's making a great connection. And you can see a bit of discoloration on the top there. It's almost like some liquid or something's got around there. I don't know. So I think I'm going to reflow that side, that whole side of that chip there. That may well be the problem I'm getting with the VRAM. But when I compare to the other pins on the other chips, these look shiny. You know, I can tell they're making good connection. But that one there, I'm not so sure. I think that might be my issue with the VRAM. And these ones at the front, they look okay as well, as do all these the DRAM on both sides. You know, I'm obviously looking at one side here, but you know, they're making good connections. But like I say, when you come to this one, they're very dull solder points, and there's just a few that, like I say, just around this area in the middle here, that just don't look as good as they could do. Certainly that discoloured one, you know, maybe that's just making a bit of an intermittent connection once it gets hot. So I'm going to reflow that side and we'll swap out the caps from the PSU. Right, well, that was a bit of an awkward one, really. I should have got my desoldering station onto it. As I say, it needed a fair bit of heat to get the cap off on that point there, the negative, I think it probably was. But if I just turn this over, you can see, you know, the pads down there looking okay. So I just need to get the new cap on there now. Something else worth quickly pointing out here. I didn't make a note when I took it off which way around the cap went. Now, sometimes you can tell from the board, it'll indicate where the negative is. Sometimes they indicate where the positive is. But yeah, I do know which way around it went because I can remember from which way the text was facing. But I'll just show you, and I wanted to just, you know, put my mind at rest and show you what you can do. On a power supply thing like this, where the negative side of the cap is always going to be connected to the common ground, that's the way it's going to work, typically. In this particular part of the circuit here, you know, the power supply where you've got the smoothing caps and stuff. Not where you've got sort of coupling, decoupling caps and stuff, that's going to be a different ballgame. If I connect to, say, that, I know that's the negative of the other cap, because if I look at the cap underneath, that's the negative pin. Set to the positive, you know, and obviously the positives are going to be separate because they're probably different parts of the power supply, different voltages. So I know by, you know, putting one of my probes on the unknown negative, if you like, of the power supply stage, the secondary output, that is the negative pin. So just checking that capacitor now, you can see 1,000 microfarad. Yeah, it ain't far off 1,000 microfarad. In fact, it's pretty much spot on. That's actually, it doesn't really need replacing, but I'm going to replace it anyway. The 6,800, I do know, is questionable. It was questionable right from the start, which is why I ordered a replacement. I'll show you that in a minute. So this one's the 6,800 microfarad cap. Let's see what this reads. On the right scale. Yeah, so you can see it's sort of hovering around 6,400-ish. It was reading as low as 5.8 that last time I checked it, and you can see it fluctuating a bit, which in my mind is a telltale sign that it's probably suffering from some leakage or something. There's probably a leakage current, I suspect. So yeah, we'll swap that out. You can see it's a pretty big beast. 6,800 microfarad. That's Panasonic as well, so we're swapping like for like with regards to manufacturer. Looks like it's the same range, I think. It's got that CEM, whatever that means. It's just a higher voltage. Not sure about the temperature. 105 degrees. What's that one? Yeah, 105 degrees. So yeah, it's okay. And the pin, if you look, it's snap. It's pretty much the same. That should fit straight on there. So that 6,800 microfarad cap's in there now, snap fit. So I'm going to trim the tops of these off to a reasonable level before I solder it. Otherwise, it makes it a bit harder with a solder pad that size. You could end up with quite a lot of solder there, and they could be protruded quite a lot. So if I cut those down by about 50% now, perhaps just under 50%. I've left, say, I don't know, 55 or 60% of the length of those, and then solder onto that. So there you go. You can see, replace the main cap. the 1,000 microfarad cap, and that was the original, I think it was a 10 that I did. It's funny, some people said that's supposed to be 100, but it didn't look like it had ever been replaced on this board, and it was a 10 microfarad, so whether it was because of an early revision or what, I don't know. And just be careful, when you've been soldering on these things, is just use a brush or something, just a brush over the whole sort of area, just in case you get like particles of solder, because that's something you know, you can get. Sometimes you might see on some of my videos after I've done some work, and I'm like, oh, look at the good job I've done, and then there's the odd particle, and what you don't see is later I go over the board like this and go over the magnifier and just inspect, just to make sure I've not got any rogue bits of solder and stuff on there. But yeah, I should be able to reassemble this now and give it a test. So I have reflowed that side of that chip there. It's not particularly clean, but it's okay. There's good connections there now, and that pin that was dark, you know, I've cleaned that up and definitely making good connections, so I'll reassemble this and we'll retry it. So as you can see there, that's working fine. Just going to test it, play for a bit with the alone in the dark, make sure it's working alright, but don't see any problems. Everything seems to be loading alright from a few games I've tried. So you can see it's worked alright. Got quite a long way into this. I've played it before, beaten it before, but it's interesting going back to this so many years later, especially on the 3DO as opposed to PC. It's a different experience. It runs a little bit slower, it's a little bit more awkward with the combat mechanics and stuff. This bit is particularly annoying, just due to putting the fall of the water in. That bit probably sinks or something, does it? No, it's not. It's bound to fall off in a minute. It's very difficult due to the camera angle here. It really is. It's much easier on the PC, this, because it was just a bit more easy to see what you were doing. And I can't see anything there. Where the hell am I? Well, there, come on. Fall off in a minute to the water, I think. Yeah, incredibly difficult game. Great fun though. You've got to try this. If you've not played this on the 3DO, you've got to check it out. About to die. Let's get the shotgun out, I think. Let's give it a blast so we can shoot that bird down. Completely missed it. And again. I don't like the kickback, it's going to knock me off the bloody platform, that. Hit it that time. Take that bird. Or bat, or whatever you are. And again. Well, I actually killed her. Not sure I'll go from here. Off into the water, I think. Anyway, thanks for watching. I'll see you soon.